Ladies and gentlemen, online viewers worldwide, welcome to the 2020 Tang Prize Laureate Lecture in Sinology. Though the pandemic has forced us to organize the Laureate Lecture in a virtual format, today we're honored and delighted to have you join us online to learn more about groundbreaking research in Sinology and the humanities to shed light on the study of Chinese culture. First of all, I'm very pleased to invite Dr. Huang Jingxing, Chair of the Tang Prize Selection Committee for Sinology, to introduce the 2020 Tang Prize Laureate in Sinology. Dr. Huang, please.
Ladies and gentlemen, it gives me much pleasure to introduce one of the most distinguished scholars in the field of Sinology, who is also the recipient of the 2020 Tang Prize in Sinology, Professor Wang Gengwu. Professor Wang Gengwu is a scholar of international renown that needs little introduction, but I would like to say a few words about his unique background and unconventional path to scholarship. For his generation, he is a rare combination. His Chinese upbringing is predominantly Confucian. His English education is largely based upon the intellectual legacy of the West, but his mind is absolutely global. Professor Wang is himself one of the overseas Chinese that he dedicated his life to studying. He lived during a chaotic period. He grew up in Southeast Asia with the idea of returning to China. When he finally returned to study in Nanjing at the end of World War II, he was forced to cut his study short and return to Malaya due to internal unrest. He later joined the University of Malaya as an undergraduate in 1949. And received his doctorate from the University of London in 1957. This unique path to scholarship paved the foundation for his groundbreaking research that unveiled a new paradigm for understanding China through Sino-Southeast Asian relations and through the eyes of the Chinese who have migrated to different parts of the world. Professor Wang represents a paragon of excellence. His work, vision, dedication, and impact have inspired generations of young scholars. Today, we are honored to have Professor Wang deliver his Tang Prize lecture on the topic From Wen to Shi, China's Road. 文史相承的中国之道. His talk will put the Chinese Wen and Shi tradition in perspective by weaving his own experiences and proposing how these traditions are still highly relevant today. I'm sure that you will enjoy this talk and find it inspiring. Let's warmly welcome Professor Wang Gengwu.
Until the end of the 19th century, the ruling class of Qing China was confident of its well-trodden road to greatness. It was confronted by the powerful British and French empires, who saw this China as an empire, but really more like a failed empire. Despite China's grandiose claims, the Europeans saw its emperors as no different from those Oriental potentates whose empires conjured up images of size, longevity, and complexity, but also poverty, stagnation, corruption, and decay. The Qing Empire's Tianxia, with its once proud civilization, was dying. What kept China together was that it was too large for any one power to conquer, and the modern empires agreed that it was in their collective interest to prop up its diminished authority. In contrast, Japanese leaders who were equally proud of their imperial past saw the danger signals and took another road. They chose to follow European ways and systematically paved a highway to military and economic success. So when Japan defeated the Chinese and the Qing court allowed the nativist Boxers to attack the Western powers, the end was inevitable. Belatedly, the Mandarins tried to do what the samurai had done and set out to change their worldview. But it was too late to save the Qing dynasty or even the idea of monarchy. New leaders had emerged who chose the republican way that in its turn led to another divide, whether to become capitalist nationalists or revolutionary internationalists. Most of the older generation hesitated, perhaps out of distaste or fear. But the bold and critical younger generation were open to whatever they saw as best for the country's future. The trials and errors that they experienced drove the Chinese to a keen sense of urgency. A reunified China would have to be based on nationalism. It had to modernize and, if necessary, embrace westernization, 全盘西化. And it did not much matter which part of the West they learned from. And in so doing, they stepped onto the rough road that led from empire to nation. The Republic turned out to be ineffective. The country was not only weak and poor, it was in the hands of warlords who fought at one another with foreign backers. And as a result, several imperialisms pushed into China from every direction. And for three decades, the country was virtually borderless. Japan was the boldest and pressured the Republican center in Nanjing until war became unavoidable. And at the height of its power, Japan controlled large swathes of territory in the eastern half of the country. China was only saved because the Japanese had overreached and lost the Pacific War. Thus, the Chinese people now could still believe in their own Wen culture and Shi history. I lived through what followed after the war, and this picture of China was one that took shape in my mind after I began to study Chinese history. For the earlier period of bitter divisions, as well as the Sino-Japanese War, I had only an indistinct image of the country that was to be my future home. My first 17 years until 1947 was spent abroad, and I saw China mostly from afar and mainly through the eyes of my parents. My father taught me classical Chinese at home, and many of the texts that he selected for me to learn touched on memorable events in China's past, but he did not teach them as history. In that way, while I was growing up in the Malay state of Perak, China became central to my life. My father told me that everything meaningful began with Wen, the literacy that was the foundation of our culture. But he held back from any reference to the Tao Tung that had dictated his own education. He was content to show me how, with this Wen, all records, the Shi records, for example, were kept. Family relationships were defined, and a Tianxia ideal was conceived. In this way, the Shi tradition enabled generations of leaders to establish a ruling system that brought order and well-being to their people. My parents did tell me that China was in danger, and I was aware that the country was now desperately defending itself. I learned about the fate of formerly well-off families, the dominance of the economy by foreign businesses, and the poverty of the peasantry, as well as the urban working classes. But my father was apolitical, and he told me only enough to alert me about what we were returning to. He was more concerned that I understood what traditional China was like. The mix of classical texts and literary gems included stories about emperors, mandarins, and military commanders. I still treasure memories of Xiang Yu rebelling against the cruel Qin emperor, and Li Ling writing to Su Wu about how it felt to be cut off from China to live among the Xiongnu in Central Asia. I memorized as much as I could of the poetry and prose of the ancients. It did not matter that it was not the language that we were using to speak with one another. These were texts that conveyed the deep feelings of longing and pride that made China endearing. My father had grown up in a time of transition. While he believed that it was China's literature that made its culture superior, another part of him wanted China to be modern. Unusual in the eyes of the Huaxiao community he was working for, he loved English literature that he had studied at university. His training in modern education methods also led him to believe that learning a foreign language could be a window to modernity. Thus, when he decided to teach me Chinese himself, he sent me to an English primary school. I realized later that he probably had reservations about the Baihua texts that were used in the local schools, and also about the highly politicized teachers from China who were active in the Kuomintang or the Chinese Communist Party. Whatever the reason, my studying in an English school would later lead me away from a traditional perspective on that world. Nevertheless, I did know how my grandfather's generation had resisted modernity. They pushed back against Western ideas and institutions by reaffirming China's Mingjiao heritage, the ancient heritage. And when that failed, like Confucian scholars like Kang Youwei, I set out to interpret the classics, reinterpret it to give it a modern thrust, even attempting to make Confucius the founder of a secular religion. In desperation, the literati class abandoned the Mandarin examinations, that knowledge framework that has sustained them for centuries. Instead, they introduced an education system that was modeled on that of Japan and the United States. While this might not have been total surrender, the will to resist after that was feeble. The schools turned to using a modified classical Chinese, popularized by writers like Liang Qichao, but even he called for Chinese history to be rewritten in the light of new knowledge. Now that was a long way from the authentic tradition that the Qing Mandarins had called for in defense of the Emperor Tianxia. But these changes were not enough. Among the radical alternatives being explored, the most successful was the Republic offered by Sun Yat-sen. Thus, the only defense remaining was through revolution, Geming. I understood very little about revolution, but saw schools and shops with Sun Yat-sen's photographs, accompanied by the warning that the revolution was not yet successful. Geming shang wei cheng gong. And they left the impression that Geming was work in progress. And as a defense against civil war and imperialist invasions, it was not doing very well. As a Chinese overseas waiting to return to the motherland, I could not see a clear road ahead and did not understand why everything was in such a state of flux. The Hua Chao greeted with relief the news of China being on the winning side in the Second World War. And I returned to China and was admitted to National Central University in Nanjing. The government there claimed victory for Sun Yat-sen's revolution. But the people I knew and I met, they knew that another kind of revolution was challenging that view. I also could see that compared with the Cold War in Europe, the Civil War in China that was taking place was brutal. While the world economy was slowly recovering, that of China was on the verge of collapse. I was surprised to find on campus how the traditional and the modern were mixed in an ad hoc sort of way. My first year was spent on classical Chinese and a course on the history of China, 中国通史. And the professor of Chinese was a product of what I understood was 国学, the kind of learning that was out of favor with those scholars who were trained in modern literature at Western universities. As for our history professor, he too had not studied abroad. He was openly political. On the one hand, criticizing communist rewritings of Chinese history through Marxist lenses, and on the other, mocking those who use foreign skills to reject the founding myths of China and accusing them of trying to force fit Chinese history into a Eurocentric narrative. We also took a course in ethics, in which the professor taught us to view Confucianism through Kantian ideas. He was an overseas Chinese from Peru who had studied in Europe and thought it was beneficial for us to approach our heritage through foreign concepts. And then there was a compulsory course on Sun Yat-sen thought on the three principles of the people, Sanmingzhuyi. And this was taught by someone that the students thought was sent by the Nationalist Party. And this was my introduction, in fact, to political ideology, nationalists and socialists in almost equal parts. An eye-opener for a Hua Chao boy whose English school had avoided any discussion of politics. University students, I knew, were a privileged group, but I did not feel that they were sure what kind of China they would one day serve. For me, what was taught was interesting, but confusing. Like all my friends on campus, I often felt we were marking time, waiting for the other shoe to drop. I did not expect to leave China after 17 years waiting to go there. I was sad when my father was forced for health reasons to return to tropical Malaya. As an only child, I could not but join my parents when they pleaded for me to leave Nanjing on the eve of the nationalist collapse. Back in Malaya, I had the most troubled year of my life. To continue my studies, I would have to get into the new university in Singapore that was set up to train its graduates to serve a decolonized Malaya. That seemed like the real meaning of my leaving China, requiring me now to think as a Hua Chao, settling down as a citizen of a foreign country. For months, it was like living in a decompression chamber. But I did learn that I could leave China, but that China did not leave me, and that even the great British Empire had to retreat to become a mere nation state. At the new university, I was introduced to nation building. It was an exciting time as I prepared to become part of a new country. But it also made me conscious of my Hua Chao origins, the need to learn about being Chinese outside China. When I trained to be a historian, the story of Kang Youwei and Sun Yat-sen visiting their Nanyang followers attracted me. The sources about their visit were limited, so I went to Hong Kong to look for more. And Sun Yat-sen had won the support of younger Hua Chao, who agreed that the Manchu rulers had failed and that the time had come to do away with the monarchy. I also learned that Kang Yu Wei's Nanyang backers did want the Manchu Guangxu restored as emperor, and that the high literati in China remained opposed to the idea of a republic for decades. That strong urge to ensure continuity surprised me at the time. In Hong Kong, I also met the historian Qie Mu. I admired his writings and found his new book, Zhongguo Li Dai Zheng Zhi De Shi, fascinating. I took for granted that China's past was based on the study of dynasties because records were kept and official histories written within dynastic framework. And this was consolidated after the Qin unification established a centralized bureaucracy to support the emperor of Tianxia. And that structure was thereafter severely tested by numerous rebellions and several foreign conquests, but it proved adaptable and survived with modifications to control large territories with many diverse peoples. Reading Qie Mu reminded me how the modern Chinese republics, modeled on France, United States, and the Soviet Union, had accepted the new narrative that displaced this Mingjiao tradition. His books alerted me to the many variables in dynastic politics and warned me not to accept uncritically any portrayal of Chinese political history as unchanging for 2,000 years. Being Hua Chao in Malaya when the authorities were fighting a communist revolt led by Chinese made us feel that we were highly suspect. All writings about modern China were banned, and no one in my history department was interested in studying China. Off campus, interest in our region had been stimulated by scholars from China like Yao Nan, Zhang Liqian, and Xu Yunqiao. They had worked with French and Dutch sinologists who discovered that Chinese sources were invaluable for the early history of Southeast Asia. I began to read what they published and, inspired by the work of Xu Yunqiao, decided to study the first 1,000 years of China's trade in the South China Sea. My vantage point was to see China from the south, and from that perspective, understand how the imperial state was pushed and pulled in several directions for 3 millennia. At the university, my history professor was open-minded. He thought that with my knowledge of classical Chinese, I could write my master's thesis all on my own. At the School of Oriental and African Studies in London, I chose to do research on the 5 dynasties of the 10th century. My early interest in 20th century efforts to reunite China had led me to think that the divided 10th century would help me understand modern Chinese history. This assumption really came from my reading of books by scholars like Chen Yingke and Fu Sinian, and through them, I realized that sinologists in Europe had extended the scope of Chinese history by using methodologies drawn from their own histories, and that I should pay attention to their writings. My research, for example, benefited from the work of Wolfram Eberhard, who was a historian and an ethnologist of the Turkic peoples in Central Asia, and that of Edwin Pulleyblanc, who was a Greek and Latin classicist, and who showed me how the Central Asian tribal armies had shaken the foundations of the Tang Dynasty, and also that of Dennis Trichard, who used modern methods to explain Tang economic history. I was surprised when London University finally awarded me a degree in medieval history, even though I had never studied the subject, and China did not have a medieval period. If I had not been in the history department, but in that of Chinese, say the Department of Chinese, my degree would have been in Oriental studies. Now that made me realize that academic borders were artificial and should not be used to hamper the quest for knowledge. What mattered was that the five dynasties I studied were most unlike the famous ones like Qin, Han, Tang, Ming, and Qing when a unified China was very strong. My research depended on Chinese records that were compiled in a distinctive Shi tradition. Ironically, while my training was in Western historiography, I was not taught the history of any European country. My British teachers were concentrating on what the West did in Asia after 1500 and on how to use local archives when doing research on modern history. I did pick up scattered bits of British and European history, but largely through my interest in literature. A great deal came from the history plays of Shakespeare, and even more from Charles Dickens, H.G. Wells, and George Orwell. And I learned much more from Victor Hugo and Emile Zola, from Goethe, Tolstoy, and Dostoevsky, even from playwrights like Molière, Oscar Wilde, and George Bernard Shaw. In addition, through courses in economics and economic history, I discovered other social and political studies of 19th and 20th century Europe and America. Therefore, much of history for me was my product of literature and the social sciences. It was not until I got to London that I realized how poorly prepared I was for graduate studies in history as an academic discipline. I tried to make up for this by reading some of the classics, like those of Edward Gibbons and Thomas Macaulay. I was overwhelmed and discouraged. On the other hand, other writings were more useful to an apprentice historian like me. For example, those of Alexis de Tocqueville and Jacob Burckhardt, Marc Bloch, and A.J.B. Taylor. I recall being especially inspired by Louis Namier and the new work on the Crusades by Stephen Runciman. And working on the power struggles of 10th century China, I found myself reading books about political struggles in the European past and was most impressed by the work of E.H. Carr and Harold Laski. Thus, my work on China fell outside its traditional narrative. It focused on the political history that drew largely on the modern historiography developed in Western Europe. I also learned from the sinologists of the Orientalist tradition. I cannot identify any institution that prepared me to study in that way, or any scholar who trained me to do that. Many teachers and writers inspired me to question whatever I was learning. And like many contemporaries of mine, I benefited from reading the work of social scientists, in particular, the anthropologists and political scientists who were interested in the past. I'm sure the different methods of research influenced what I wrote about the political divisions of 10th century China, although I'm unable to pin down the specific influences. I mentioned how much I learned from modern Chinese historians like Chen Yike. I should also add the work of Quan Hansheng, Gu Jiegang, and Japanese scholars like Naito Konan and Miyazaki Ichisada, who are all open to Western historiography. I did not question the Confucian legalist concept of dynastic legitimacy behind the wars of reunification. In my approach to the five dynasties, the Tang emperors were still sons of heaven, Tianzi, during the last quarter of the 9th century. Although half their lands were under the control of local army leaders who who only nominally acknowledged their sovereign. When the remnants of a rebel band seized the throne and founded the Liang dynasty, several provincial commanders made themselves kings, Guo Wang, and then three sets of Turkic leaders claimed the throne and gave themselves dynastic names. One did so even after surrendering 16 border prefectures to the powerful Khitan and paid tribute to the Liao emperor. The Song dynasty that reunified the Tang territories never succeeded in getting the 16 prefectures back. Instead, it battled to survive in the north, moved its capital south of the Yangtze, and finally succumbed to the Mongol Kublai Khan, who ended the Chinese Tianxia altogether. The Chinese historians knew that the five dynasties never ruled China, but they did not hesitate to line them all up, all five of them, with those that did, both those before and those after. I wondered when this spiral towards total division began. The question led me back to the late 9th century, to the 880s. Further readings brought me to believe that the power structure that made the Song reunification possible was established by the year 950. By focusing on a specific set of questions, I felt I could ignore the official end of the Tang Dynasty in 907 and the end of the Five Dynasties in 960. However, I was not qualified to challenge the continuity framework regarded as the best way to understand China, that is, dynastic China, and I did not try to do so. When I began teaching at the University of Malaya, the history department there followed the periodization that best explained the modern West, roughly 1500 to the end of the Second World War. And that was not at all useful for explaining modern Chinese history. Fortunately, I could devise my own courses, and I also worked on Southeast Asia as a region, and also the role of the overseas Chinese in its history. The region was in the grips of the Cold War, so I also paid more attention to the modern and the contemporary. In particular, the events leading to the Cultural Revolution in the People's Republic of China exposed my inadequate understanding of Chinese history and made me even more frustrated at not having access to books and documents about what was happening. I tried to follow the work of Chinese scholars who had scattered to different cities and countries, notably in Hong Kong, Taiwan, and North America. I noted that social scientists were using the methods of Soviet studies to study Maoist China. And this was found to be unsatisfactory, and sinologists were brought in to help. For a while, something called area studies was developed to train new China experts. In a different way, the People's Republic scholars were also forced to use Marxist lenses to fit the China into a Soviet knowledge edifice. At the same time, Mao Zedong was determined to eliminate the Confucian heritage altogether. It was a time when the idea that China's Shi history might still have value was considered traditionalist and had very little support. This was a sobering moment to examine the way that I had been studying my China and the Chinese. The trigger for me was the Cultural Revolution. When I attended international meetings with themes like China in Crisis, I asked why Mao Zedong was calling on the Chinese people to destroy their cultural heritage, and why young Chinese seemed ready to follow him. It was unacceptable that someone teaching Han history for years like me did not know how to explain that phenomenon. So I moved away to the Australian National University in Canberra, where there were fine collections of books and documents on modern China. That university offered me the freedom to study the People's Republic of China along with Chinese history. I could also continue my interest in Southeast Asia and the ethnic Chinese. That move was a good decision that allowed me to look afresh at China. Working with the narrative that I had taken as a norm, I saw Mao's China struggling to find its future after throwing out its past, its own whole past, China's own past, and rejecting the liberal West as well as the Soviet alternative. I could not see where it was going, but had to conclude it had become a quagmire of its own making. I arrived in Australia in 1968. 4 years later, diplomatic relations were established, and my colleagues and I made our first visit to the People's Republic of China. By that time, I had read my fill about post-1949 China, including the Cultural Revolution that was still going on. I was surprised that Mao's followers were using the Confucian past to denigrate Zhou Enlai and all those who were deemed to be not revolutionary enough. The few historians we met explained that the People's Republic had rejected China's ancient heritage and also Western imperialist knowledge. But Mao Zedong now accused Soviet leaders of betraying the tenets of Marxism-Leninism and claimed that he alone knew where communism should be going. That was the last phase of Mao's peasant proletariat worldview. After his death, Deng Xiaoping restored power to his old comrades, the Chinese Communist Party. I noted that he permitted the return of Guo Xue scholars, who are now older and wiser. He also enabled the Chinese people to see that their heritage was not some sacred given that should be respected and ignored, but was an instrument that could be retooled to meet the needs of the country. That promise of openness did not last long. Two events changed the plot. The Tiananmen tragedy of 1989 revealed that China did not welcome what the liberal West was offering and what many of the young seemed prepared to embrace. The party reaffirmed its agenda to reunify the party and regain credibility. The other event was the collapse of the Soviet Union. When the Cold War ended, the United States became the world's sole superpower and reviewed the role of China in that new order. The triumphant West now emphasized universal values as the proper measure of human progress. China, therefore, should be subjected to globally valued judgments. A strategic analyst began to predict that China could become a formidable rival in the not too distant future. All that time, scholars working abroad, including foreign nationals of Chinese origin, were exposing the way the Chinese Communist Party had abandoned key Chinese values and abused the classics for political purposes. Their work challenged the regime's legitimacy. Two examples show that the PRC leaders were sensitive to these attacks. One concerned ideology and the other was history. China's concept of ideology could be compared to what was transmitted through the Chinese classical canon, the Jing, the classics. There was no agreement what would replace these classics. From the modern list that ranged from Sun Yat-sen's Xiamenzhuyi to Marx's Capital, Das Kapital, to Mao Zedong's Mao Yulu, the quotations. But as in the Chinese past, it did not much matter whether any text should have absolute priority. To the Emperor Tianxia, it was enough that the Wen, the text, would support central power and shape the system's collective memory. They were most useful as in the form of the shi, the records of every dynasty. This Shi history went beyond mere utility. In its totality, it provided continuity for all of China's past. Now, both Jin and Shi served China in ways that did not fit the modern narrative. They depicted the Emperor Tianxia as different from the empires that could be broken up to become nation states. And from the outside, I saw how millions of Chinese overseas had acquired their new nationalities. That has shown me how different groups of Chinese sought to connect with their ancestral past, even while the revolutionary young in the People's Republic were eschewing such imagined links as ignorant and backward. So when confronted with the empire to nation narrative, most Chinese overseas were not convinced. China's sovereignty had passed from the Qing to the Republic. Imperial rivalries left the Republic's legitimacy unchallenged, even though it controlled less than half of the country. There were actions on the ground to detach Manchuria, Mongolia, and parts of Xinjiang from China, and also calls for self-determination for Tibet. But at the end of the Second World War, the Republic's claim to the Qing heritage was sustained. When the United States and the Soviet Union supported the decolonization of the national empires, both the Republic of China's and the People's Republic's sovereign borders were accepted by the United Nations. The Chinese abroad took that as well-founded on the strength of China's Wen and Shi heritage. In that context, Mao's Cultural Revolution was a source of anguish and incomprehension. And Deng Xiaoping's promise of reforms was well received. Deng's reference to socialist spiritual civilization, cultural construction, and an undefined set of Chinese characteristics was puzzling. But some could point to the return of Confucian revivals with renewed hope. More openly, both Jiang Zemin and Hu Jintao turned to classical Wen texts that seemed to be more than mere symbolism. There was also strong support for the standard Qing Shi to connect the end of the Ming with the beginning of the Republic. Now, this was seen as completing the job that the nationalists had failed to finish. While Xi Jinping is yet to see that work published, he has affirmed the historical place of the three Maoist decades. Now that way, he linked Deng Xiaoping's reforms through the years 1949 to 1978 directly to the Republic of China and the Qing Emperor Tianxia. Now this may be a filial act of a child of the Cultural Revolution, but he can see that choosing the well-trodden path of Wen and Shi would gain the regime wide approval. The process of reconnecting to Confucius as sage may be largely symbolic because it is not a vehicle to drive the future. What it does is to provide the PRC with a better defense of its legitimacy. If China's past was rooted in the ancient Emperor Tianxia, it was never an empire of the current narrative. It had its own line of descent down to the 20th century before it gave way to a sovereign republic in a new world order. China's quest for modernity, however, has taken the country to a more powerful, centralized bureaucratic state. In so doing, it replaced the emperor with the party as the core of a new authority structure. In that framework, the nation could now try to avoid becoming one that is founded on the supremacy of an ethnic majority like most other nations. It could instead try to become one that consisted of multiple ethnicities bound together by their fealty, their loyalty, to the Chinese Communist Party. And that way, as a party nation, using progressive Wen texts and with a continuous Shi history, the People's Republic might be able to secure the future that he has promised its people. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Wang, for inspiring us with your insights. Ladies and gentlemen, this concludes the 2020 Tang Prize Laureate Lecture in Sinology. Thank you all for joining us today. Please stay tuned for the announcement of the 2022 Tang Prize Laureate in Sinology.